Hi everybody, welcome to Mr. Drew Paints With You. I'm Mr. Drew and this is my official voice reveal. Thank you so much for joining me here. Here's a picture of what the final drawing will look like at the end of this video. In the first video for this series, I showed you how to do the line drawing. That's where you measure everything out and get your outline ready so you know where your shadows are supposed to go and all your shapes. The second video showed me blocking in the shadows, so I basically had a two-value system at that point where you can see where the light side is and where the shadow side is. In this video, I'm going to show you the final stages of my drawing for this plaster cast. I usually don't have the time in class to fully render a drawing for my students, so being on YouTube, this is awesome. It gives me an opportunity to show them and anybody else watching my whole process without taking up too much class time. This stage is all about subtlety. You need to gradually build the tones and adjust the shapes, kind of like you're sneaking up on the final product. By the way, do you know how you catch a unique rabbit? Unique up on it. You know how you catch a tame rabbit? The tame way. So there's a little bit of a corny joke for you. Any of my students who I've had before probably have heard that, so I apologize for the redundancy there. So anyways, yeah, in this stage you really want to sneak up on those values and those shapes. It's way easier to build gradually rather than to go too dark too quickly and then have to go back and erase. Anytime you have to go back and erase your work, it's going to get all smudgy and kind of messed up. Not only that, but you're kind of destroying the grain of your paper, so you might not be able to get the value you're looking for if you press too hard with the pencil too soon in the drawing stage. Here, as I'm blocking in the lighter tones for the drawing, I believe I was using an H and a 2H at this stage, and I'm holding the pencil way back, really far back on the end. That way I apply as little pressure to the tip of the pencil as possible, and I can just lightly scratch the surface of the paper and float those values in. You'll see a little bit later I actually use one with a pencil extender, and it's a full-length pencil. It's not like I need the extender to hold on to the pencil, but if I could get my hand even further away from the tip of the pencil with that extender, that allows me to get some of those very light, sensitive tones in those light areas. At this stage in the drawing, I'm still adjusting shapes. Many of these soft shadows, if you notice the shadow in the left corner of the mouth as we're looking at it, the left side there, the little dimple underneath the lower lip, the shadows on the lips themselves, the shadow in the philtrum, that central dip on the upper part of the upper lip there. Many of those shapes are so subtle, and even though I do my best in the drawing stage to outline those and give myself an idea where those need to go, at this point in the drawing, I'm still focusing on that and adjusting those shapes as needed. So not only am I trying to sneak up on those values and get those the right darkness or lightness, but I'm also trying to sneak up on those shapes and add the subtlety there. Right there on that right side of the lower lip, you can see a very bright spot that's covered just by a little bit of kind of a mid-tone to the right of that. There's a really nice subtle light that's hitting there. So I put in the lights and some of the mid-tones. And here, once again, keeping with that theme of sneaking up on the values, I am still darkening the shadows. And you'll see throughout this video, there are several stages. I'll darken them here, and then I actually go and darken them again and just keep refining it. That's really what ends up taking quite a while for this whole process. I would say that this step in the drawing process takes the longest. It took me about 1 hour to do the line drawing, about 3 hours to block in the shadows, and then this stage was probably about 5 or 6 hours from the beginning to the end of this video. I actually was able to listen to an entire audiobook at this stage here. So make sure you get yourself some good listening materials and keep yourself entertained as you're drawing. So many of us really wish there were shortcuts to drawing or painting, and I'm sorry to tell you that there really is not any shortcuts. You just need to put in the hours. That being said, some mediums do go quicker than others. Usually, if I'm going to do a drawing, I prefer using charcoal. It's just a little bit more immediate. I can get the values and the tones darker quicker. There's some other benefits to charcoal, but graphite is probably the easiest medium to use, especially if you're beginning. It's very easy to control. Charcoal sometimes just gets out of hand. It's really smudgy, can get really messy very quickly. So graphite is a really beautiful medium. It just takes a long time. This technique, the school that I went to, this technique we referred to as smooth tone shading. And a friend of mine actually pointed out that he can't find any other school that refers to it as smooth tone. Everybody else calls it veiling, and it's the same process. It's basically using small little circles to build up your shadows. And occasionally I'll use some linear marks to get my shadows in there. But if you use small little circles, it's a lot easier to get an even tone and not get streaky marks or a value that you don't want. Using that circular motion, you're also able to soften your edges very effectively. I'm always telling my students, don't use a blending stump, don't use your fingers to smudge. Not that there's anything wrong with that, but it's very easy to lose control of your edges and to get kind of a messy, smudgy look. So this technique, using small little circles to fill in your values, it allows you to build up the tones and also get soft edges without having to rely on a blending tool or smudging it with your finger. There really is, I know there's professional artists who use their fingers to smudge and to blend, and that's fine. I can't say I've never done that. I do that, you know, if I'm doing my own projects on my own and, you know, not a demo for my students. But, you know, if I do that, sometimes I do sense that the oil really mixes in with the graphite and it'll bind itself to that paper. And sometimes you're not able to lift those values out if you need to go back and erase. So just be careful if you're going to smudge. And if any of my students are listening, don't smudge. Just use this little circular pattern technique to fill in your shadows there. The time factor is probably also why I really enjoy oil painting. And by the way, I do plan on taking a break from drawing videos after this, and I'll be doing some more painting demos for you. After all, this is called Mr. Drew Paints With You, so we'll get some more of those painting videos up. And I know oil painting can take a very long time as well, but there's something very immediate about that, where you can mix up the exact color and exact value that you want and just plop it on the canvas. I don't have to slowly and gradually build up to it. So I enjoy that in the oil painting. It seems to go a little bit quicker for me than this type of a graphite drawing. As far as content goes, I have a lot of ideas for videos. I'm still trying to figure out the best format, though. I'm trying to figure out things like how long should my videos be? Is it more helpful to show time-lapse, or would you rather see real-time videos? So I'd really love to hear your thoughts or any comments you have, so feel free to comment on this video or any of my other videos if you've got some ideas or what would be more helpful for you to see. The reason I launched this channel is I had a friend on Facebook. I posted a painting and he asked if if I could show a video of the whole process, and I said I don't know how. So he said, well, you got a smartphone, just use that. So that was my first few videos, just on my iPhone with the time-lapse option there. And so that was fun. I was able to put those up on Instagram and Facebook and LinkedIn. But then I decided I want to get a little bit longer videos, because what I found with the iPhone app that I have, and I have an iPhone SE, I know it's getting old now, but still works fine for me. But with the SE time-lapse app, it just condensed everything down to about 30 seconds. So whether I was drawing for an hour or painting for 6 hours, everything got condensed down to about a 30-second video. And so I was feeling that it was just going too quick and you weren't really able to see what was happening there. So then I got another app that allowed me to do multiple videos and then link them together, and that way I could get a longer video. So this video here, I know it's about 20 minutes long, and feel free to scrub through to any of the sections if you want to see the, you know, the last part sooner, that's fine. So I'm trying to find that balance. How much is too much, or how much is not enough? So give me some ideas. I'll probably try something with my next video. I plan on doing some, maybe oil painting some facial features for you. I may try doing that in just real time and see how that goes. So let me know what you think about these, and if you have any other ideas that would be helpful to you. For at least half of this stage, I went back to mechanical pencils for filling in, smoothing out, and refining shapes. Mechanical pencils, if you don't know, you can actually get different weight leads or different hardness leads for them. So if you have maybe like a box of artist pencils, you might see that they have everything from maybe 4H up to 6B or things like that. And so those pencils have different hardnesses and allow you to get either lighter or darker values. You can also buy those for mechanical pencils. You can get a range from about 4H to about 4B, I think. Some of my favorite mechanical pencils, and I may put a link down in this description there, but some of my favorite mechanical pencils are the Pentel Graph Gear. Right here you see me using a Pentel Graph Gear 500 in 0.5 lead. I recently found the Pentel Graph Gear 1000, which is now my favorite mechanical pencil. It's really nice. I like the extended barrel on these. It's got a very long pointy tip, so you can really get in for some good detail areas. But that tip is so fragile that if you drop it and bend it, it's just going to crack your lead every time you extend it or push the plunger on the back. But the Graph Gear 1000, you can actually push the pocket clip and it retracts that really skinny metal tube at the end, and that way it keeps it protected. So yeah, the Graph Gears are beautiful pencils, and I really do like the mechanical pencil lead. I'd say especially the Pentel. I know there's a lot of different brands. I've experimented with a few different brands, but to me the Pentel mechanical pencil lead seems to have about the smoothest consistency out of all of them that I've tried so far. And if you've got any ideas or any suggestions for materials and methods and techniques, I'm always excited to hear about those. I'm kind of a fanatic when it comes to art supplies. There's that H pencil with a pencil extender, so I can hold it even further back and try to get some of those light tones and some of those mid-tones in the drawing. You'll see me going in with the kneaded eraser, and in this stage a lot of that is just picking out some of the spots that got a little bit too dark. The paper, sometimes it seems like it doesn't behave or it doesn't cooperate with you. This is a Strathmore Bristol board, and I think it's 140 pound paper. So it's a nice, good, heavy paper. I really enjoy working on it, but sometimes it's a little frustrating to me. There is a rough side and a smooth side. Usually you can tell if you hold it up to the light, you'll see more dimples on the rough side. So I'm using the smooth side here. I prefer a smoother texture, but still sometimes I'll skate my pencil across and I'll still end up with a little speck that gets too dark for a certain area. And that's where the kneaded eraser comes in. You can mold it to a really fine point and just dab out those little dark spots and then go back to even it out with a harder pencil. My drawing students have a cast drawing due tomorrow, and I was pushing to try to get this out for them this weekend just to maybe give them a little boost and give them some process they can look at as they're working on their projects. So I'm sorry to all of you. I know it's really late, and you're probably already in your dorms now. But maybe next year, maybe this will be more helpful for students next year. But the process really applies to any drawings we'll do. So our next project, we're going to do our first full portrait. And so any of my drawing students can watch this still just to see how the whole drawing is built up from the shadows to the midtones to the lights and how that's developed. You'll see that little piece of paper underneath my palm there. That's not an accident. It just didn't get stuck to my hand. I intentionally taped it there. I learned that trick from J.D. Hilberry. I don't know him personally, but watching his YouTube channel, he talks about protecting your paper. And any of you who have done any amount of pencil drawing or charcoal drawing, you know that eventually you're going to smudge your hand through that graphite or that charcoal, and you'll get that beautiful dark edge on your hand and start smearing it all over your paper. So keeping a piece of paper taped to your hand, it can really help protect your drawing. It still can smudge a little bit if you really push down on it and smear it across your drawing, but it's going to protect your drawing from smudging and also protect your paper from getting the oils in your hand on the paper. You know, it's going to be some nerve-wracking work, and you might get sweaty palms start dripping on your drawing. That's nasty. Oh, there's my Pentel Graph Gear 1000, my new 0.5 that I just got in the mail today, thanks to Amazon. It's a thing of beauty. It's even got a little indicator right by the finger grip. If you put one of those harder or softer leads in, you can rotate it to remind yourself what type of lead you have in the pencil. So I thought I got the shadows dark enough, but after judging compared to that really dark background, I found that I still needed to push the shadows darker. And you may be wondering, why is there just that little speck of black on the left side of the drawing? Well, in the beginning, I like to find my darkest value, something as close to black as possible, and I put at least a little bit of that in. It's particularly helpful if it's right next to one of your shadows on your subject, because that's a small jump. If I try to compare the value of that deepest black to maybe a mid-tone, like one of those lighter values on the upper lip, that's a big jump, so it's harder to hit that mark. But here, if we have a dark value next to your shadow, and your shadow is maybe only one value lighter, it's a lot easier to compare that and to judge that and to get that right, judging next to that black value you've got in there. So there, I'm pretty sure that's about as dark as I want that to be, but then that means I need to go back and darken up some of those other shadows in the chin area, the lips, underneath the lips. So that's that back and forth, that sneaking up on it. I started by establishing my shadows, then I started to float in some of those lighter values. And then I saw once I got some of the lighter values in, I needed to push my shadows darker. Once I pushed those shadows darker, then I noticed that some of my mid-tones have to go a little bit darker. So it's just feeling your way through these values and these shapes, working up to it gradually. Oh, and by the way, I'm not really a fan of my voice, and if you're not either, feel free to turn the volume down. You're not going to hurt my feelings. Well, maybe you will. Just don't tell me that you did that. The midtones, I was meaning to mention that. That's the parts that transition from shadow to light. They're still considered part of the light family, but those are so important. I could get all the shadows in there and it still would look like a mouth, it would still be identifiable. But those midtones, that's really what's going to help add a sense of roundness and volume to your drawing and give you some real depth to it. The midtones and the reflected lights are a lot of fun to play with. You can see reflected lights underneath the upper lip, on the bottom part of the upper lip, there's some reflected light there. That's light that's bouncing off the lower lip up into the bottom part of the upper lip. So that's really fun to play with. It adds a lot of form and interest to those areas, but you got to be careful not to get that too bright. So the midtones need to stay in the light family, and those reflected lights need to stay in the shadow family. There also is a little bit of reflected light underneath the lower lip. That would be light bouncing up off of the chin into that area underneath the lower lip. Drawing from plaster casts is a lot of fun. This is a cast made from Michelangelo's sculpture of David. We have a series of these casts. There's an eye, an ear, a nose, a mouth. So fantastic practice for getting used to drawing features of the portrait. And one of the nice things about drawing from a cast is that it's usually just white or off-white, so you don't have to worry about a lot of different local colors, where if you're actually drawing a mouth on a friend, you know, a mouth from the model, you're going to have all the different colors and the skin tones, and sometimes that can be confusing, especially if you're starting off in drawing. So if you're just starting to draw, maybe go to an antique store, go to you know, Hobby Lobby or Michael's, look for like a little white sculpture, something with some nice shapes in it, and put a spotlight on it, get yourself some nice light and shadow, and that is an excellent way to practice drawing and a great way to start seeing values. As I mentioned, I'm still kind of a noob to this whole YouTube, so you call me a noob-tuber, maybe. So I'm trying my best to learn as I go. There's quite a bit to learn, but thankfully there's a lot of resources online that are very helpful when figuring all this out. So I'm trying to make improvements as I go. The next video, I think I'll actually use my DSLR, my Nikon camera, to record that. Hopefully that'll be a little bit better picture quality. I know some of these with my iPhone, they're okay, but it does get a little bit grainy, a little bit shaky. And if any of you are video editing wizards, I would love to hear your suggestions on that also. I just got this lapel mic in the mail today, so I'm excited to use that. And hopefully it's helpful to hear the thought process behind the drawing. So yeah, if you have any questions about any part of this process or anything, please let me know and I'll be happy to answer those questions for you. We're listening to is Compliments of Mr. Tchaikovsky, famous composer of the Nutcracker Suite. One of my favorite composers of all time, I'd say, would be Tchaikovsky. I have some Russian heritage, so for some reason I'm kind of drawn to Russian music and Russian art. Some of my favorite artists from the past and currently are Russian artists. There's kind of an honesty and a boldness to their way of painting. If you want to see some really impressive portrait drawings, go look up Nikolai Feshin, who was a a Russian immigrant who came to the States probably back in the 20s or 30s. I should probably do my fact checking before throwing out dates and numbers like that. But he came to the United States and lived in New York for a while, and then eventually moved out to New Mexico. I think it was for some health reasons, but he kind of established an artist colony out there, and some of his portrait drawings, just incredible. Just fantastic work done with vine charcoal on rice paper, and they exhibited so much control and so much knowledge of anatomy, and he was able to infuse so much character into his drawings. It's almost like they have more life than what the model did. So here, just going back and refining. And to be honest, at the end of this drawing, there's still more I could have done, but I need to take a break. I have other projects to work on and grading to do. But I feel like I got it to a point where you can start to see that finished quality. And I mentioned earlier, that's kind of the goal here, where I love doing demonstrations for my students, but there's not always enough time in the class to to do a full 10-hour drawing or 15-20-hour drawing. And I don't claim to be the best at this method of drawing. There's others who are way more accomplished, people like Sadie Valeri, J.D. Hilberry. One of my colleagues, Dave Hamm, is just incredible with doing the smooth tone or the veiling techniques. But this, I think, gets the point across. Down there at the base of the chin, that's a couple of those shapes I was mentioning where they are so subtle, those little kind of amorphous shadow shapes. You can't really define them completely, so you have to kind of sneak up on those. Here I'm putting a dark background around the cast, mostly just to give some contrast, especially that right side, that light side of the mouth there against the white paper. It kind of disappears, it doesn't stand out. So getting some nice contrast with that black background is going to help your cast drawing, or whatever your subject is. It's going to help it pop out really nicely. And there on the right side, I'm not just blindly following the line that I had previously. I'm still looking at my source and seeing if I need to adjust that contour or that outline any as I fill that in. And something important to note is whenever we're drawing something, there really is no outlines. You may say, oh yeah, I see an outline at the bottom there of the lower lip. That's more of a coarse shadow. And the edge of the cast, it's not really an outline. It's just a hard edge going from a light shape to a dark shape. There you saw kind of a little pause in the action. I was hunting around for some graphite sticks that I thought I saw here in the studio recently. I'm trying to just get this done as quickly as possible now, just blocking that background for contrast. So if any of my students are watching, this is really not the best way to do the background. I would take more time to try to smooth it out and get an even tone. And for my students, I do want them to carry that background out to the borders on their paper. But here, just for demonstration purposes, I'm trying to flesh that out a little bit more, give you some of that dark background for contrast. And you can see that starts to let the cast pop out more. So here again is the finished drawing. Thank you again so much for watching, and hope you have a great night, great day, whatever time you're watching this. So thank you again. And I'll see you next time.